Welcome to my NDDS class of essentially of BPharm fourth year, which begins with this chapter Sustained and Controlled Release Drug Delivery System, also known as SRDDS or CRDDS in short. So we begin with the class today. I am Preeta Bose, Assistant Professor of JIS University, and I'll be taking your NDDS class via this video mode. So moving on to the second slide, we have the contents of this presentation, where we can see that it is beginning with the definition of sustained release and controlled release drug delivery system. Next up, we have the comparison of drug release profile, the advantages and disadvantages of SR and CRDDS, the drug selection criteria for SR and CRDDS, classification of oral SR and CRDDS, evaluation of the both, application of the both, and conclusion. So what exactly is sustained drug delivery system? Sustained release are drug delivery system that achieve slow release of drug over an extended period of time after administration of a single dose. Controlled drug delivery system, on the other hand, is a drug delivery system which maintain constant level of drug in blood and tissue for extended period of time. The comparison of the drug release profile is what you can see over here via this graph, which is a conventional systemic drug infusion and controlled local sustained drug release profile. So here you can see that it is a time versus concentration graph, where the tissue or plasma concentration is given on the y-axis, and on the x-axis we have the minimum effective level, which we can see over here. Now if you just enlarge this a little bit, you would see that we can see the conventional profile here, the control profile or the sustained release profile can be seen here, and the therapeutic concentration range can also be seen. Also we can see the toxic levels here. The toxic levels are at the higher level, and the middle portion is the therapeutic concentration range. This is a control profile which exhibits the zeroth order. It is a zeroth order release where rate of release is constant to maintain constant tissue concentration. Now, advantages of sustained release and controlled release drug delivery system. It improves absorption utilization, thereby enhancing the bioavailability, decreases local and systemic side effects, reduces gastrointestinal irritation, reduction in dosing frequency, the frequency of the dosing can be reduced, better patient acceptance and compliance, because patients do not have to take this particular drug many times during the day, reduce fluctuations in circulating drug levels, reduction in the healthcare cost, because you only have to make this medicine or this medicament, just you can make it once daily, and that is enough for a person to be taking it. Bioavailability of certain drugs can be increased via this. Next up, we have the disadvantages of sustained release and controlled release drug delivery system. Now we have dose dumping in sustained release and controlled release. We have dose adjustment, where dose adjustment is very difficult for these. Patient education is required for successful therapy. Patient needs substantial additional information as to the proper use of sustained release product. It is not the same as your normal product. It will be a little bit different for sustained release. Poor IV-IVC. IV-IVC is in vivo in vitro correlation. Higher cost of single unit as compared to cost of single conventional unit, and also there are some stability problems involved. Drug selection criteria for oral sustained and controlled drug delivery system. There are these are of three types. One is the physicochemical properties of the drug, the pharmacokinetic properties of the drug, and the pharmacodynamic properties of the drug. Next up, we will go into details of the physicochemical properties of the drug, where we have so many points here. So the first point is the molecular weight of the drug. This is something which you have to check before you are preparing any sort of sustained release or controlled release preparation. The aqueous solubility of the drug, whether it is being dissolved in water or not. The apparent partition coefficient of the drug. drug pKa and ionization at physiological pH, the drug stability, which is very important. If the drug is not stable, then you cannot prepare any sort of medicament using this. The mechanism and site of action, the biopharmaceutical aspect of route of administration are of three types again. They have subtypes. One is the oral route, one is the intramuscular or subcutaneous route, and the last one is the transdermal route. In your next presentations, or rather in your next, like when we go on with this NDDS syllabus, you would be able to understand these much at a much better rate and a much better pace, because you have all these oral routes, intramuscular and transdermal routes in details over there. Next up, we have the pharmacokinetic properties of the drug. There are five subpoints of the pharmacokinetic properties. First is the absorption rate. Second is the elimination half-life. And third is the rate and extent of metabolism. Fourth is the dosage form index. And fifth and the last one is the plasma protein binding, which has to be seen in order to prepare these kind of drugs. Third is the pharmacodynamic properties of drug. The pharmacodynamic properties of the drug are again of two types. One is the therapeutic index or the range, which you have to see. And plasma concentration response relationship. This is also very important. Next up, we have the classification of oral sustained and controlled drug delivery system. Sustained release and controlled release are essentially of three types. One is the continuous release system. There is a delayed transit and continuous release system. And also there is a delayed release system. The controlled release system not only a controlled release system, but also the sustained release system. Both of them essentially form any one of these three parts. So we would go into details of the first part, that is the continuous release system. Now these systems release the drug continuously for a prolonged period of time along the entire length of the gastrointestinal tract with normal transit time. Now different systems under this class are dissolution controlled release system, diffusion controlled release system, dissolution and diffusion controlled release system, where both the mechanisms are playing into being, ion exchange drug resin complexes, slow dissolving salts and complexes, pH dependent formulation, osmotic pressure controlled release system, and lastly we have the hydrodynamic pressure controlled release system. So all these will be coming under different positioning, where you can see here we have a nice chart given over here for you to easily understand what forms under what. So under dissolution control, we have matrix system and reservoir system. Under diffusion control system, we have matrix system and reservoir system again. Both these subtypes are same, but the main point is different. And for diffusion control system, again we have the matrix and the reservoir system. But under matrix system, we have again two types. One is the rigid system and one is the swellable system. And this swellable system consists of natural polymers, semi-synthetic polymer and synthetic polymers at large. So first we begin with the dissolution controlled release system. These systems are most commonly employed in the production of enteric dosage forms. Now enteric dosage forms are those which will enter your body, go into the stomach, sit over there for the entire time being through which your entire digestion process is taking place, and then it passes itself into the intestine and then it releases. So the drug present in the system having high aqueous solubility and dissolution rate. Now matrix system under dissolution control release system, it will look like this, a soluble drug. If you can see, this matrix system is like a mesh for, this is like a meshwork. So there is soluble drug in the middle and a slowly dissolving matrix on the outside. Now this matrix which we are showing over here, this matrix is a slowly dissolving matrix. That means that this matrix will dissolve very, very slowly, giving prolonged time to the soluble drug to be dissolved inside the body. So your matrix system is also called the monolith, since the drug is homogeneously dispersed throughout a rate controlling medium. This slowly dissolving matrix which we have seen over here is your rate controlling medium. Examples are beeswax and carnauba wax. Next up we have the reservoir system under dissolution control release system, of course. Here also, if you can see the picture, you would see soluble drug is there and slowly dissolving erodible coat is there. So this coat will get eroded, unlike the previous matrix which is a dissolving matrix, and this erodible coat is something which will erode
with time. So slowly dissolving erodible coat means it will erode over a longer period of time. So the drug particles are coated or encapsulated by one of the several micro encapsulation techniques. It will slowly have the dissolving materials like cellulose, PEG, polymethacrylates, waxes, etc. In diffusion control release system, what happens is the movement of drug molecules, we will see a movement of drug molecules from a region of their higher concentration to one of their lower concentration. Now this particular mechanism we have learned in osmosis. The main thing what we have learned over there is that drug molecules move from a region of the higher concentration to one of the lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. This is the typical definition of osmosis. So under diffusion system, if you can see the picture, you will see what exactly is happening here, what is happening at time 0 and what is happening at time t. Under time 0 is what is the initial phase and time t is your final phase. So these are two different pictures which we are marking with. Next up, in this diffusion control release system, which is of two types again, matrix system and reservoir system. So under matrix system, the drug is dispersed in an insoluble matrix of rigid non-swellable hydrophobic materials or swellable hydrophilic substances. In the reservoir system, these systems are hollow, containing an inner core of drug surrounded in a water-insoluble polymer membrane. Last, we have the dissolution and diffusion control. So under this category, we have both. We have dissolution control as well as diffusion control. Now this picture, if you see, what you will see is we have an insoluble membrane on the outside, which is porous in nature. You can see small pores over there. The entry of dissolution fluid happens, there is drug diffusion, and the pore is created by the dissolution of soluble fractions of the membrane. So the membrane will have soluble fractions, that means not the entire membrane will be soluble in nature, but there will be parts of the membrane which are soluble in nature. So that is your dissolution and diffusion control release system, essentially what it is. Next up, we have the ion exchange resin drug complexes. It is based on preparation of totally insoluble ionic material. Resins are insoluble in acidic and alkaline media. They contain ionizable groups which can be exchanged for drug molecules. You can see the equations given over here. It's pretty easy to understand. The slowly dissolving salts and complexes, the salt or complexes of drug which are slowly soluble in the gastrointestinal fluid, can be used for controlled release of the drug. Example is penicillin G has been complexed with N-dibenzyl ethylene diamine to give benzethine penicillin G. So that is your slowly dissolving salts and complexes. Under osmotic pressure control release system, if you go by this picture, you'll be able to understand what is happening over here. So this is an osmotically active core. There are drug molecules inside it. Gastrointestinal fluid is entering from the three sides. The blue arrows are your GIF, like your gastrointestinal fluid is entering. After entering, what happens is, like, it is entering through the semipermeable membrane because it is an osmotic controlled release. So your semipermeable membrane is a barrier between the drug molecules and the gastrointestinal fluid. Now there is a drug delivery orifice over there and the drug is getting released after the fluid is entering through this semipermeable membrane. Next up, we have the hydrodynamic pressure control release system, where you can see again there's a beautiful diagram given over here by which you can understand what happens here is we have annular openings at the bottom and there is a liquid drug formulation in the inside. The inside is formed of a liquid drug formulation. Outside it, we have a shape retaining housing collapsible drug reservoir. It is collapsible in nature. It is a shape retaining one. It will retain its shape even though it is collapsible in nature. So it will collapse and it will retain its own shape after some time. A swellable hydrophilic polymer is given inside it so that the liquid drug formulation can be delivered through the drug delivery orifice. Through these annular openings, the liquid from the outside will enter. And thus we have a hydrodynamic pressure control release system. Sorry. Next up, we have the pH dependent formulation. Such systems are designed to eliminate the influence of gastrointestinal pH on dissolution and absorption of drugs by formulating them with sufficient amount of buffering agents. Examples are like salts of phosphoric, citric or tartaric acid. that adjust the pH to desired values as the dosage form passes along the GIT and permit drug dissolution and release at a constant rate independent of gastrointestinal pH. Delayed transit and continuous release system. These systems are designed to prolong release of drug with increased residence time in GIT. Such dosage forms are designed to remain in the stomach. Therefore, the drug presented in such systems should be stable at gastric pH. This class includes following systems: altered density system, mucoadhesive or bioadhesive system, size-based system. So these are your three types of systems which are given over here. So this is your altered density system. The presentation is a little haywire because I am recording this via a mobile device and the presentation doesn't really always open perfectly, but yes, I can assure you that you can understand after seeing this video. So if the residence time of the drug in the stomach or intestine is prolonged in some way, the frequency of dosing can be further reduced. Altering the density of drug particles, use of mucoadhesive polymers and altering the size of the dosage form. Types are two. One is a high density pellet and one is a low density pellet. The mucoadhesive system or bioadhesive polymer cross-linked with polyacrylic acid when incorporated in a tablet allow it to adhere to the gastric mucosa or epithelium. The size-based system, the diameter of the tablet always is greater than 2 cm, which cannot pass through pylorus and cannot go into the intestine. Using high polymers, like high density polymers rather, like HPMC K200, having high swelling property will not let it enter into the enter through the pylorus, and hence that particular medication will not go into the intestine but will remain in the stomach for as long as it has to work. Delayed release system. These systems are fabricated to release the drug only at specific site in the GIT. The drugs, those are destroyed in stomach or by intestinal enzymes known to cause gastric irritation, absorbed from specific site in intestine, are formulated in such systems. The two types of delayed release systems are intestinal release system and colonic release system. So just two types. First is your intestinal release system. A drug may be enteric coated for intestinal release for several known reasons. To prevent gastric irritation, destabilization in gastric pH. Now you must be thinking, what is SA? Like, why I'm skipping the SA? SA is such as. So if I'm repeating this line, then the line would go like, a drug may be enteric coated for intestinal release for several known reasons, such as to prevent gastric irritation, destabilization in gastric pH. Colonic release system. Drugs are poorly absorbed through the colon but may be delivered to such a site for two reasons. First is your local action, as in the treatment of ulcerative colitis, and systemic absorption of protein and peptide drug like insulin and vasopressin. Okay. Now these are your evaluation of sustained release and controlled release tablets. What do you have to see in order to evaluate a formed tablet? First and foremost, you have to see the appearance, next friability, hardness, thickness, weight variation, tablet density, drug content, in vitro release study, in vivo study, diffusion study, stability study, bioaddition or mucoaddition test, IV-IVC, floating capability and kinetic modeling. So these are some of the evaluation tests which you have to go through when you are preparing any sustained release or controlled release tablets. All these specifications are given in the Indian Pharmacopoeia. So you have to do these in order to get your tablets passed. So these are your evaluation for your tablets, and next up we have the evaluation for the sustained release and controlled release pellets. First are the tablets, next we have the pellets. So for pellets we have friability, weight variation, tablet density, drug content, floating capability, in vitro drug release, kinetic modeling, in vivo study, diffusion study, expiry date determination and stability study, bioaddition or mucoaddition test, IV-IVC. So there are many common points between tablets and pellets. Also there are some which are completely different, so you have to know these, and these are very important. Now, evaluation of sustained release and controlled release capsules, if we are going by, it's very less. Weight variation, drug content, in vivo study, in vitro drug release and stability study. Next up, we have the application of sustained release and controlled release drug delivery system. The applications in the following drug delivery system are oral control drug delivery system, gastroretentive drug delivery system, that is also known as GRDDS, ocular drug delivery system, transdermal drug delivery system, intestinal drug delivery system, and colonic drug delivery system. Now, why I did not elaborate this particular application, like this particular slide on application has not been elaborated, because all these are one chapter of yours. Like each chapter of NDDS will form a part of your application, where this oral control drug delivery system is a chapter, the GRDDS is a chapter, the ocular is a chapter. So we are all going to do these in the next classes. Hence, I did not elaborate this. You only need to know the names right now for your application of SR and CRDDS. But yes, you need to know the marketed products. Some of this marketed products I've given over here. If you go by the marketed products, you will see the composition is given, the product name, and the manufacturer is also given. Like I've also given you the company's name. So if it is a carbamazepine, which is a drug, product name is Zenretard, manufacturer is Intas. So Intas is a very big company who manufactures carbamazepine in the form of Zenretard. Diclofenac sodium, name is Dick SR. It is manufactured by Deep Pharma Limited. Diclofenac sodium, again known as NAC SR. Manufacturer is Cystopic. Diclofenac sodium in the product name of Overan SR, sustained release SR. It is manufactured by Sibagleri or Glegi. Nifedipine, a very famous drug. The product name is Depinretard. Manufacturer is Cadila Healthcare, very famous company again. Composition, Theophylline. Product name is Theopa. Manufacturer is Welcome. These were your tablets. Next up, we have the capsules. So capsules of diazepam, known as Elcoin. Manufacturer is Ranbaxy. Diclofenac sodium, known as Dicotal CR. Manufacturer is Blue Cross. Indomethazine, known as Indoflam TR. Manufacturer is Recon. Nitroglycerine, product name is Angispan. Manufacturer is Leica. For transdermal, which you are applying directly onto the skin, you have nitroglycerine, known as Nitroderm TTS. The manufacturer is Sibagleri. And nicotine or nicotine patch is applied on the skin. Again, the manufacturer is Sibagleri. Next up, if we move to the conclusion, the last part of our slide, we will see that the sustained release drug delivery system is very helpful in increasing the efficacy of the dose, safety of dose, as well as the patient compliance. Because patient compliance is something which we always aim to have, no matter what happens. The controlled release drug delivery system aims to release the drug at the desired rate over extended period of time to maintain the therapeutic level in the blood. The therapeutic level or the therapeutic dosage form of the drug has to be leveled up in the blood. It has to be at a perfect level. So for that, what we do is we prepare controlled release drug delivery system. So hope I was able to explain to you what essentially sustained release and controlled release drug delivery systems are. In the next videos, I will try to explain in more detail so that it becomes even more clearer to you. Thank you for being a part of this video. Thank you.